Welcome to Business Statistics 1 class. So in the previous video, we had seen about the bivariate and multivariate frequency distributions and what you mean by marginal and conditional frequency distribution. So today in this video, we will see how to construct a frequency table. So given a available raw data, we have to construct a frequency table. So for that, we require some of the steps. So the first step is the range of the variable should be obtained. That is, how to obtain the range is you have to check in the data what is the highest value and what is the lowest value. So the range formula is highest value minus the lowest value. The second method or step is choice of class intervals. So the class intervals are obtained by proper division of the range into subranges. So here you can say these are the general rules for construction of frequency table. The first rule is the number of class intervals should ordinarily be between 5 and 20. With more than 20 classes, this study may become bit difficult or tedious. And when you consider class intervals which are less, number of class intervals less than 5, so a lot of accuracy will be lost. So choosing a proper number of classes is very important. So this can be done with the rule. Otherwise, sometimes whenever you look into the data, you can directly understand what number of class intervals should be taken. If not, you can use this formula, that is k equal to, k is nothing but number of class intervals. So k equal to 1 plus 3.2 log n. Here n is the total number of observations in the data and log n is its common logarithm, that is common logarithm of n. So you can use this formula when you want to calculate number of class intervals. Otherwise, by observation method, you can you can get to know how many class intervals are required. So the next general rule is, as far as possible, the class intervals should be of equal width. So this will make the calculations easy. The next rule is, the class intervals should be such that the structure of the data is not altered much. The size of the class intervals should neither be too large nor be too small. So the next rule is, the class intervals should not overlap. They should exhaust all the variate values. The next rule is open-end class intervals should be avoided. So we had seen in the video what do you mean by open-end classes, like where either the lower limit of the first class or upper limit of the last class will be missing. So such type of classes should be avoided. The next rule is the class limits, mid values, etc. should be integers or simple fractions. So using some integers for class limits or mid values or widths, etc. So if you use integers, so that will make your calculations easy. Instead of integers, if you are using some complicated fractions and all, so solving and preparing a table will be very difficult. So you have to use some simple integers. Integers or simple fractions. The next rule is, depending on the variable and the degree of accuracy, inclusive or exclusive class intervals may be used. So if the variable is discrete, inclusive classification can be used. In most of the cases, we'll be using exclusive type of class intervals. So depending upon the data, you can decide whether to use inclusive or exclusive. So the next rule is method of obtaining class frequencies. So once you are done with the class interval, you have to note down the class frequencies. So after choosing the proper class intervals, they should be written down vertically, one below the another on a sheet of paper. So you have to prepare a table. So once you're done with choosing the number of classes and what class interval, which should be limits and all, you have to write it down vertically. So we'll solve a problem so you'll get to know it better. Okay, so once you write down the class intervals corresponding to every observation in the data, a tally mark is made against the class interval to which it belongs. So for example, if the class interval is 0 to 5 and in the data you have a data like example 10, 15 or 2, 3. So if a number belongs to that class interval, you have to mark a tally. Tally is nothing but a horizontal line. It looks like this. So these are called as tally. So every fifth tally corresponding to any class interval should be placed across the previous four tallies. So if in a class interval there are five times a variable is repeated, so once you are done with the four tallies, the fifth tally should be marked as a cross. So this is how you mark class frequencies. So once you are done with the tallies, so you have to count how many tallies are there and you will get the corresponding class frequencies. So when the data are voluminous, for quicker processing, computers are used. So for your examination purpose, they may ask question with some 30-40 observations and they'll ask you to prepare a frequency table. So you have to follow these steps and prepare a frequency table. So in today's class, we have seen how to construct a frequency distribution given a raw data. Let us first, you have to know what is the range of that data and you have to calculate how many number of class intervals that should be included and what is the width of the class interval, size of the class intervals and whether it should be an inclusive or exclusive type of class intervals. So all these steps should be carefully calculated, and then once you are done with the class intervals, you have to see the number of frequencies corresponding to that class interval and mark a tally, and then you'll get to know the number of frequencies. So now let's see a simple problem where the heights of 20 students are given and we have been asked to form a frequency distribution. So the question is, the following are the heights in centimeters of 20 students. So the data is 163.3 centimeter, 155 centimeters, 169.9 centimeters and so on up to 160.8 centimeters. So this is the height of 20 students. So the question is, form a frequency distribution with appropriate class intervals. So whenever you have a raw data, the first step is to find out the highest value and the lowest value. So here in this table, observe and find out the highest and the lowest value. So we can see 178.9 is the highest value and 145.2 is the lowest value. So as I said, we'll get the range, that is highest minus lowest value, so we'll get it as 33.7 centimeters. So once you get the range, so here the range is 33.7 centimeters. So you have to decide what you want to choose the width of the class interval as. So here I have chosen the width to be 5 centimeters. So now to get the number of classes, you can simply divide, that is you can take the ratio of the range to the width. So we'll get the answer as approximately 6 point something, but you can't take a class interval as 6 point something. So the nearest value would be 7. So I have taken 7 class intervals, this, that is 145 to 150 up to 175 to 180 centimeters. So you can see one here, the highest value is 178.9, which is included in the last class interval. So now there is no need for you guys to take the class interval of 180 to 185 centimeters, because there is no student whose height belongs to that class intervals. So this is how you can easily find out the number of class intervals. We know that height is continuous type of data, so exclusive classification can be used. And here 145.2 is the lowest value, so the first class interval may be from 145 to 150. So you can even take 140 to 150, but here we have chosen the class interval width to be 5 centimeters. So we have taken 145 to 150 as our first class interval. Then, as I have said, we are using exclusive type of data. So the second class interval is 150 to 155 centimeters. So up to 180 centimeters we have taken the class interval. So here we have taken 180 because the highest value is 178.9. So there is no need of taking 180 to 185 centimeters, because the range is up to 178.9. So you have to choose wisely the class intervals and the width. So once you are done choosing the number of class intervals and all, you have to start with the tally marks. So just see 163.3. So where does it belongs to? So 163.3 comes in this class interval, that is from 160 to 165. So I have marked one tally bar. So the next data is 155.0. So note that this is an exclusive type of data. So you're not including over here, but you have to include it in the third class interval, where the lower limit is 155 to 160. So again, I have marked a tally bar. So similarly with detailed observation, you have to mark each of the individual data. For example, you can see 160.8, so it belongs to the fourth class interval. So it belongs in 160 to 165. So you have to mark another table. So let me show it for particularly one class interval, that is, I'll take it for 160 to 165 class interval. So here 163.3 will be included in that particular class interval. Then we have 163.9, and the next value is 160.0, 164.7, and 160.8. So there are 5 values that belongs to the class interval 160 to 165. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and for the 5th value you have to mark a cross. So this is called as tally bar. Suppose if there are another 5 observations, then you have to mark another set of tally bar. So this means that there are 10 students whose height is between 160 to 165 centimeters. Suppose there are 13 students, so this is how you represent. So once you are done with a tally bar, then you have to count and write the frequency. So similarly, write the tally bars for all the other class intervals. So this is, you have to observe carefully and mark the tally bars. So here we are done with the tally bar. So here you can see there are 4 tally bars. So the frequency is 4, which means that 4 students whose height is between 145 to 150 centimeters. Similarly, for 150 to 155 centimeters, there are 3 students, and for the class interval 155 to 160 centimeters, there are 6 students. So you can see how the tally bar is written. So for the class interval 160 to 165, there are 5 students. For the class interval 165 to 170, there is 1 student. So there are no students whose height belongs to 170 to 175 centimeters, and 1 student whose height is between 175 to 180 centimeters. That is the highest value. So when you add these, it should be equal to the given number of students, that is total. So we know that there are 20 students height is given in the data. So this value and this value should be same. So suppose you will get 18, then again you have to cross in this data and see where you have missed, and you have to add that particular value. So in today's video, we have seen, given a raw data, discrete data, how to form a frequency distribution. That is, first we have to note down the highest value and the lowest value, and we have to find out the range. So given the range, we have to choose how many class intervals we have to calculate. So here the class interval is 7, of width 5. So you can take even width as 10 centimeters, but in such cases the accuracy will be lost. So it is better to take the width as 5. So once you are done with the class intervals, you have to mark the tally bars and calculate the corresponding class frequencies. So that's it for today's class. Thank you.